No go. She brought stain remover to put on my sweatshirt. There's a stain on my sweatshirt. She had to. It's right there.
Thank you. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus again, or my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.'" But God said to him, "You fool. This very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get to what you have prepared for yourself?" This is how it will be with those who store up things for themselves but are not rich toward God. We're going to continue worshiping the God who knows where we place our value. We pray that we'd worship him this morning. Let's continue.
I believe in the risen one. so we are just honored and blessed to be able to share music with you today.
Well, good morning, everybody. Man, it's almost fall, the fall back. We got to try one more time. Good morning, everybody. There we go. Very good, very good. How about I know we don't normally like clap in church and stuff, but I think, you know, the youth, it's amazing to me to watch them up here and playing all the different instruments, and they did a really good job. So I think we should give them a round of applause. Very good. Well, they worked really hard, and they've been working hard to be a part of worshiping with us as a congregation, so it's very exciting. Before we dismiss our children, though, we have a missions moment this morning, and so I'm going to invite Kevin Fannin to come on up, and he's going to share with us some things that are happening around ISI. So good morning, Kevin, and welcome. Great name, by the way. Here's the clicker. stay here and we'll pray. Yeah, before Kevin takes off, I would just add a couple things. Number one, he talked about the friendship family thing. It's so much fun. I mean, I know that Rohit wasn't really one of our he wasn't a part of the program, but he became our international student that we spent a lot of time with. He loved seeing the girls because he was, you know, he missed his own family. That ultimately led us, meaning my wife and I and our girls, to go to India for his wedding. And we had a great time. I know that that's probably not the norm, but it can be, right? And so there's a lot of opportunities to make those connections with international students. And so if you haven't done it or you're like, maybe, like, take a leap of faith, sign up, check it out for a year, and if you don't like it, don't do it again, right? And so it's just an opportunity to involve somebody else in your family life, and they have a great time. And so, but before Kevin leaves, I just wanted to pray for ISI and for the ministry that they have going there. We'll continue to pray. So join me. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for ISI here in Rapid City, and they have places all over the country and the world, Lord. And we just pray for them right now as they continue to welcome new students. Lord, we are thankful that they have the opportunity to gather in person. Lord, we think of the opportunities that everyone that goes there to be a part of either a Friday night meal or a Bible study or part of the World Changers group or wherever those opportunities are, Lord, you are at work and you're moving in those students. And we pray for Kevin and Heather and all the other different folks that either volunteer or work with ISI here to reach out to students, that they would just continue to have a huge impact in these students' lives. But Lord, we're also thankful for all the different congregations, including ours, that continue to pray for their ministry. And we just ask that you continue to do that. Lord, we pray that you would give our people a heart for missions and that they would just continue to, whether it's ISI or other ministries that we support here at the church, that we just continue to pray for those because they are making an impact and we're excited to see your hand at work. And so we thank you for that and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Very good. Well, we're going to go ahead and dismiss our children for Children's Church. So ages 3 up through 4th grade. Mrs. Wiebe is at the back there waiting to go. And so she always enjoys hearing the missions moment as well. She leads the missions committee, and they have a great time talking about and getting updates from all the different missionaries that we support. So you can also reach out to her if you have other questions. But as you came in this morning, you should have received a church bulletin. Mine's already starting to fall apart because I've been opening it and closing it and writing things down. We have a number of announcements. It seems like as we head into fall and school started and all this stuff is going on, we just we get busy. So my wife has told me she's taking over and making some announcement. There was a cupcake decorating dilemma yesterday, and so I'll let her explain.
It was a cupcake emergency. Had to have an emergency meeting and everything. So we did have a miscommunication with Katie Wilkins, so she will not be coming now. So I don't know, Jessica, are you doing it or with help with someone else? Carrie and Jessica will be doing it instead, but it'll still be amazing. So, and it is $5. That covers just part of the cost. We will provide everything, cupcakes, frosting, the tips, the bags, the personality, the jokes, all that stuff. So it should be a really fun time. So please come. There is childcare available. But please sign up in the back. And I think that's it. I just want to explain why we're not having Katie Wilkins come. So depends on how good you want them, you know. Dad jokes are free. We're moms. We don't have dad jokes. But I also want to encourage you guys to check out the stuff in the back as well with the ISI. And I just need to plug Friendship Families because it's a ton of fun. I mean, Rohit, but we've also had so many other ones. I mean, I would have never taught somebody from Bangladesh how to drive a car. That's an exciting experience. So you're missing out. All right, thanks.
All I can say about the car driving, lots of horn honking. And if you go to Bangladesh or India, you'll have a much better understanding because they honk at everything. And she's like, why are you honking the horn so much? Well, I just wanted them to know I was coming. They know you're coming. They see the car. You don't need to honk. So it was lots of fun, though. So, and the funny part is that same student bought a car from his uncle in California. And he's seen more of the United States than probably all of us in this room put together. He's driven that car everywhere. It's amazing to, like, you'll be on Facebook and you'll be like, oh, I drove from New York to Florida just to see what the scenery looked like. I'm like, really? Like, okay, you know. So anyway, it's very fun. On with announcements. We have the Central District Conference is coming up here November 3rd to the 5th. We just are bringing it to your attention. We just want to be praying for that time as the leaders in the Central District Conference get together and our meeting. If you remember that, please take a few minutes just to pray for them as they gather and talk about different things that are going on within that conference. That's the conference we're a part of as a church. So the next thing is the Youth Conference is coming up. So November 17th to the 20th, I think there's still just a little bit of time to sign up. He's giving me a thumbs up with the little bit of time. Ages 13 to 18, if you need more info, please reach out to Pastor John. He will give to you all the information that you need to be able to have your youth take a part of that. I know that our girls have really enjoyed going when it comes around, and so just be aware of that. Next Sunday is November 6th, and I'm not going to be here, but it is the time to make that time change, and it's the fall, so we fall back. So if you show up at the normal 9:45, that's really 8:45, you'll only be 15 minutes late for Sunday school. So we'll redirect you to the other building, and you guys can enjoy that, and then come over and enjoy the service. And so just as a reminder, when you set your clocks on November 5th that night, set it back an hour, and then you will be right on time. Pastor Daniel asked me to mention that we're looking at having another baptism Sunday, and so we're looking at November 13th. That's right around the corner, but we had a whole bunch of baptisms just a couple weeks ago, and that obviously spurred some interest of people that wanted to do it, and so make sure you reach out to Pastor Daniel if that's something that you're looking at doing or interested in doing, and we will get you hooked up. And I asked Marshall to put a wave on the slide because that's how Pastor Daniel usually baptizes people, with a big wave, and then it comes out protecting the electronics over here. So it's going to be a great time. Let's see. I think that's all the announcements I had. Is Ainsley in here? No. Oh, right there. It's her birthday tomorrow, right? Yeah, okay. I thought so. I was like, I got it wrong one year, and now I put it in my phone so I don't forget. What? Oh, Sterling's is tomorrow too? Oh, and Jessica, look at this. Our professional cupcake decorator, filler-inner, is going to be having her birthday too. So anyway, that's all the announcements that I have for you this morning. We're going to encourage you to stand up, say hello to those around you, and then after a few minutes, the worship team will bring us back together.
look. She was so focused. I tapped her. She didn't even look.
Oh,
no.
What?
I tapped her, and she's just over there.
Yeah. James 14:13-17. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why? You do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone, then, knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thanks. Please take your Bibles this morning and turn with me to James chapter 4. James chapter 4. So last Wednesday, it was Bible dress-up night here at Awana. And my family happens to love Bible dress-up night. Unfortunately, my kids are drawn to some of the more violent stories in the Bible. So Sam went as Sisera, the guy who had a tent peg put through his head. And Noah went as Abimelech, the guy who had a rock dropped on his head. I think they get it from Shelley. But this year, we might have to put a limit on the amount of gore and bloodshed happens at Awana. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray that your Spirit would be at work in our church this morning. We pray that the Spirit would draw us towards you so we could see your Son Jesus as the Savior and Redeemer. We pray that you would open our hearts towards you, that you would fill us with your love and your presence. We pray that you would speak to us as we study Scripture. In Jesus' name, amen. Do you have a plan for the future? Do you like to be prepared? Different people prepare in different ways. For instance, my wife Shelley is a very thoughtful person, and she cares about the details. She will remember everything. So on our calendar as a family, she'll write down appointments and doctor visits and church meetings. I like to be more unpredictable, which means I don't have a plan. I'm more of a go-with-the-flow kind of person. And it drives my wife crazy. Over the years, I've realized that, oh, if we're going on a trip, I got to follow the schedule or else this will be really frustrating to her. In our passage this morning, James is talking about how we make our plans, especially in light of God's sovereignty. Over the last several weeks, we've been moving through the book of James. And studying James is a lot like studying the book of Proverbs from the Old Testament because it's wisdom literature. And so James gives us a Christian perspective on what it means to be wise. Wisdom is controlling your tongue. It's resolving conflict with other Christians. It's caring for the needy. In other words, it's not just words, the things we say. It's demonstrated by our actions, doing the right thing at the right time. And it's important to, if we're going to be wise, to evaluate our plans. How do we make decisions? Are we prepared for the future? The future can be a giant question mark because it's uncertain. We don't know what's going to happen. What about the economy or the upcoming election? Or will Nebraska win another football game? I don't know. Like, there are a lot of people who think they know what's going to happen. But we're not in ultimate control over our lives and what happens. James reminds us that God is in charge, and we must interpret our plans in light of God's plan. Let's pick it up this morning in verse 13. He says, "Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow." James is addressing the businessmen in his congregation. And for the most part, these guys are pretty successful. They know what they're doing. They're good at making money. In the ancient world, most people worked in some sort of agricultural business, whether it was raising crops or taking care of animals. But you also had merchants, guys who would travel around and they would buy and sell. I had a good friend in Colorado who was a rancher, and from time to time he would speculate on the futures. So he would buy cows based on a price that they would be down the road. That's kind of risky, but it was a way for him to hedge his bets, so to speak. He used it as an insurance policy. Not everybody uses it that way. But life is unpredictable. Life is uncertain. In the Gospel of Luke, Jesus told a parable about how the ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. So he thought to himself, "What should I do? I have no place to store my crops." So this guy has a good problem. He has a harvest, and it's so abundant that he has no place to store everything. He said, "This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store my surplus grain. Then I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry." He has a plan for the future. He's going to retire young, maybe start a little brewery. But here's the point. He's going to enjoy his golden years. That is, until God says to him, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself?" It's important to understand what's going on here. This man has a plan. He's prepared for the future. Unfortunately, somewhere in his plan, he forgot the most important part. What about God? What about his coming kingdom? One day, every one of us will stand before our Creator, and we must give an account for our life. This man was a fool because he forgot to factor in the most important thing, the starting point to our plans, God's coming kingdom. James says, "What is your life? You are but a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes." Life is short. We're here for just one precious moment in time, and then we're gone. You're born, you live, you die. You're a vapor. He's using a metaphor from the book of Ecclesiastes in the Old Testament. King Solomon described his quest for meaning and how he kept chasing after the wind. And he uses the word vanity. He says everything is vanity. The NIV translates that word meaningless, but that really misses the point here. He's not saying that everything lacks meaning. The Hebrew word is the word for breath. It's the word for a vapor. He's talking about how life is fragile. It's temporary. It's transitory. It's here, and then it's gone. I like to think of a spray bottle. Like, my mom used to iron clothes, and she would use this little spray bottle and then send out a mist. It's there, and then it's gone. When I was a kid, I used to laugh at my parents because my mom would talk about how fast life goes by, and she would say, it feels like yesterday. Feels like yesterday I graduated from college, or it feels like yesterday I got married. Now I find myself saying that as I look back on the different moments in my life, living in Chicago, going to Bible school, meeting Shelley. It all blends in together, and now we have 6 kids, and we're taking them to school and back again and going to church and work, and sometimes you lay down at the end of the day, and you're like, what just happened? Like, where did the day go? Where did the year go? Well, according to James, life is short, the future's uncertain, but God is in control. God is in charge. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. Now, when we talk about God's will in Scripture, we need to make a distinction between God's moral will and his sovereign will, because they're not the same thing. When we talk about God's moral will, we're talking about his instructions for life. This is how God wants us to live. For instance, the Apostle Paul said, it is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn how to control your body. That's God's moral will. It's our sanctification. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father. In both of those passages, they're talking about God's moral will, how he wants us to live. And here's the thing, it is not hard to figure out God's moral will. It comes from studying Scripture and learning the truth and applying it to your life. But God's sovereign will is a little harder to understand. This is God's plan for history. And sometimes we don't see God's plan except for in retrospect. We're talking about how he governs the affairs of men. Nothing happens by accident. Nothing happens by chance. In fact, even the bad things, the suffering in our life, is a part of this plan. In the book of Isaiah, it says that Jesus, the Messiah, was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. But it was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. Isaiah doesn't mean that God found some sort of sick pleasure in the death of his son. That's not the point. He's talking about how Jesus' death was the punishment for our sin. He bore the legal burden that we deserved. On the cross, he was our substitute. And so we can say two things, that on the one hand, Jesus' death was a tragedy. This was the murder of the Messiah, a righteous man. And yet, on the other hand, it was through this tragedy that our salvation came about. God the Father, through God the Son, restores us to being his children. Jesus endures the cross for the joy that's set before him. That's God's sovereign will. And I think that's how James uses this phrase. He says, instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, you ought to do this or that. We don't always know what the future holds. Life can be a mystery. It's uncertain. And we don't always understand God's plan. So we have to be flexible. At times, life can send us a curveball. God might have a different plan for us. My freshman year of college, I was a student at WNCC in Scotts Bluff. And my goal was to attend Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. That's where my youth pastor, Andy Grease, went to school. And Andy talked about it in such glowing terms that I wanted to go to Moody. But Moody's sort of selective. It can be hard to get in. I had really good grades. I thought I had good references. There's no reason why I shouldn't get in. But then I got this letter on January 17th, and I opened it up, and I read that my application had been declined. And to make matters worse, one of my best friends, who also applied to Moody at the time, he was admitted. And so the whole thing didn't make sense to me. My plans for the future at that moment were shattered. I was disappointed. But now I can look back at that moment because instead of going to Moody right away, I ended up getting to go to Frontier. And that's where I met Shelley. If I had gotten into Moody when I wanted to, I would have never met Shelley. Today I'm grateful because I can see God's plan as I look back in the rearview mirror. I didn't understand it, but God was orchestrating the events in my life. Whenever we make plans, they're always subject to change. Instead of saying, I'm going here, we should say, if the Lord wills, we will do this or that. There's an element of contingency. We're always submitting to God's leading. Anything else is boasting. He says, if anyone then knows the good they ought to do it, or the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, for them it is a sin. Now, in Scripture, there are two types of sin. You have sins of omission and sins of commission. Sins of commission is when we commit a sin, when we do something that we shouldn't do, right? God says, don't do this, and we do it. Well, a sin of omission works the other way. This is when we sin by not doing something that we should do. At first glance, this verse seems a little random. Why does he suddenly bring this up? It might feel like it comes out of nowhere, but it's really the logical conclusion to the argument. If life is uncertain, if time is short, then procrastination is really a tragedy. Procrastination is wasting your life, wasting your time. If there's something you need to do, and you know it, then go do it because your life is a vapor. Maybe you need to apologize. Maybe you need to read Scripture more. Maybe you need to spend more time with your family. God has given you only one short opportunity in time. Don't waste your one and only life. In Ephesians, Paul says, be very careful then how you ought to live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Time is not on our side. There was a song when I was a kid, I'm not going to sing it, but time, you're no friend of mine. I can't sing like Darius Rucker, and I won't submit you to that. But we're called to redeem the time, to take something that's bad and bring it to be something that's good. Back in the day, the Romans had a custom where whenever a general had a great victory, they would hold a parade for the general. Crowds would gather and the soldiers would march. And at the very front of this parade, there would be a general riding on his white horse. It was a very prestigious moment, the highlight of any general's career. And it would be very easy in that moment to let the whole thing go to your head, to get caught up in it. So they would appoint a slave to be right next to the general. And this slave had only one job. His job was to repeat the words, memento mori. In Latin, that means, remember, you will die. The slave was there to remind the general of his own mortality, the brevity of life. This last week, I was talking with Pastor John, and we were talking about funerals, and how as a pastor, one of the opportunities you get is to share at funerals. And it can be a difficult experience, but it also can be a very rewarding experience as a pastor. Because at a funeral, everyone there is focused on life and death. We're focused on what is most important. What is life about? And it's hard to forget your own mortality. I once heard an old cowboy speaking at a funeral, and he said, we all have to take a turn in the box. That's That's the truth. Everyone here is going to die. But here's our hope as Christians. We know that death is not the end. Yes, time is short, but we serve the God who makes life again, who restores. Jesus conquered death. That's the power of the resurrection. On the cross, Jesus died for us. On Easter, he rose from the dead. And so he holds the keys to death and Hades. He opens the grave. And one day he is coming back to establish his kingdom. We need to work now because the time is short. His kingdom is coming. Our time is precious, and we must seize the day for God's kingdom. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the gift of life, for the gift to breathe each day. We pray that we would use each of these breaths to honor your Son, Jesus, to live well for his kingdom. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rescue the
Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight